said, my body's starting to get uncomfortable now. It seems to be higher.
Now I'm placing my hands, asking if this is the area, and I'm also using my body as a way to pick up the information.
I feel like there's something way up inside. It's almost like when I turn into my chest and his chest and this side, it's like I get winded and that part is very heavy and I don't feel real good right there. And it's probably his physical heart or the lungs. If I was running, I would have probably a small pain in my heart.
He has a problem with his valves in his heart.
The valves in the heart, no wonder.
He has a murmur.
He has a heart murmur?
About 2 months ago. He was given an EKG and he was given a sonogram and they found that his valves just don't work properly.
Yeah, and it feels to me like the right ventricle feels like it feels like it's the one to check with them. Ask the vet, call the vet.
She walked in immediately. She sensed that there was something in his chest. She didn't know exactly what it was and eventually came to his heart. And I'm not positive, but I think she picked the ventricle also that was bothering him.
Yes,
tell
us if you can. Watch this one down with my voice. I'm very talking.
Watch
be careful with me, and I want to get very quiet and soft and back off and, you know, don't come at me real fast. And Lord, she just is, she's very apprehensive, and I almost feel sad, and I don't know why yet. All right, so this one is another one that needs to be outside just a little bit more. You know, just out there, even. It seems to start too much.
She's tried to jump out of the store.
She needs to go out. That's
we have a gate on her. We have to put a gate up because she tried to jump out of the top of the railing and she got her legs caught.
Wouldn't it be easier if we just took her outside?
She also stings a lot, so man. She's trying to tunnel out there.
It's just she says, if I keep trying, just quiet and keep trying, maybe you'll pay attention to me. Yeah. That's what it is. So they need to get her outside. She needs to see the sunshine and the wind.
She's locked in one of those dolls every day, except for the training. There is no place.
Hold steady, sweetie.
It'd be like you guys locked in here all day long, every single day.
And they're going to take you out. You're going to get to go outside.
You're doing something that you don't want to do.
Yeah.
We are.
You can see the trees.
Maybe I should stop it now.
Yeah.
Maybe I should get her and fix
smell
it.
That?
It'd be wonderful to stop it.
She likes to run, so I'm telling her that when she starts to eat again, yes, that she's going to get to run. Yeah. Oh, you want to climb in my pocket, huh? Well, if you were a little smaller, I'd love it if you climbed in my pocket. And you know you have to eat.
Seen with Samantha, I think they have to start to accept more what she's capable of doing. And I think they will, as they're exposed to it more.
Yeah.
one of the few horses that have ever told me that I like to run, but she was missing her family, and so that's why she stopped feeding. She didn't understand why they sent her away to go on the horse circuit. They go on a circuit for a whole year and go to different racing events like Belmont Race Track, Del Mar Race Track, one in Mexico, and they travel. There's lots and lots.
Growing up with my mom, I lived in...
Is that your daughter?
Yeah, that's my daughter. Actually, she's 39 now. All right, now...
Does she have the animals too?
No.
She believe you?
Does she believe me? Yeah, she's seen me do work with many different beings. Yeah.
Does she believe you at first when you first told her?
I think, you know, when you have a mother that's kind of strange, because they used to say to me, Mom, don't talk strange to my friends. Don't do anything strange, because talking to animals was pretty strange. And still, it still is a little bit. But then, we're talking, you know, Heidi was, well, she's, as I said, 39 years old.
She's older than you.
She's what? She's 39. My son is 40, I'd be 41. So we're talking a long time ago. So the only time that they really solicited, really and truly, my help regarding the animals, and was really quite proud that I could talk to the animals, was Christopher came home one time and he said, "Hey Mom, you know, my best friend, their parents are going to take their dog to the pound. And he's devastated. The dog won't stop barking. And can you do anything about it?" So it was the kids that snuck the dog over to the house. And I sat down and I thought, gee, I've never done this before. So remember yesterday we talked about how many of you could actually hear the dog, the sound of the barking in your head? Yeah, you know how you can hear your dog barking? So that's how I started. What I did was I closed my eyes, I had the dog sitting in front of me. I gave him two visions, and the first one was a barking, 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 then picking him up, putting him in the car, driving to the Humane Society or a pound, taking him out, putting him in a cage, driving away, and not coming back. Then I gave him another vision, two or three barks out, and then growl. Because this dog was needed to talk. Some animals need to verbalize. So I couldn't just say, hey, you can't make any sound. So what I did was hear the two barks or three barks, and then if you're frightened, just use a low growl. People won't get close to you if you growl. Growl and walk and then listen. Remember yesterday we did the thing with being real quiet and using our ears, our ability to hear spherically. So that's what I did with that dog. It changed. They went home. The dog never did that incessant high barking again. Then about a week or so later, Heidi comes and says, hey Mom, so-and-so's having problems with their dog. So the kids were sneaking the dogs to my house, and I'd sit down and then talk about what the behavior was that needed to get changed. Then I'd give them a vision of exactly what to do. That's where it's real important. Be clear what you want your horse to do. Be clear what you want your dog to do. See them doing an alternative behavior. That's really the key. When you write down what you want them to do and what the alternative is. Let's say a dog's... The whole reason I started to get into the public, when I was young, not only having learning problems, I didn't feel like I fit in anywhere. I was an artist. I could paint. But I didn't feel like I had a brain that worked. So it made me just, I didn't fit. I didn't fit in any schools. There was no place like this to go to get help, to find an alternative way of learning. So I was pretty devastated. And I would just consistently turn to the animals. So finally, when I grew up and realized that I actually talked to them, and that by giving clear pictures of being that animal doing it, I could make a living doing this. So then, people start bringing their animals to me, and I I'm getting to be known as the little lady in Escondido that talks to the animals. So one lady brings this dog in, Springer Spaniel, a cute little dog. And she's with her little 7-year-old girl. And the little girl looks at me like that I'm going to save the world. I'm going to be able to help her dog, and she's going to be able to keep this dog. Because her mom and dad said, if it doesn't stop its behavior, because it went to the bathroom right beside itself in the house, no matter where they were, if it had to go to the bathroom, it'd just step a couple feet over here, squat, go, and that's it. And they tried everything to get this dog to stop. So the mom says, you know, it's going to pound. And so she's devastated. She's 7 years old. This is her baby. And she hears about this lady in Escondido that can talk to the animals. And she pleads with her mom, because the mom doesn't believe that this is possible. So she pleads with her, please, please, let's just try this. So they bring the dog in. His name's Wags. Now, up to this point, I didn't do any teaching. I was scared to talk to people and absolutely terrified to stand up in front of the group. So I'm sitting there with Wags in my office, and the lady says, well, he's a perfect dog, except for one thing. He goes to the bathroom in the house right beside himself, and we can't get him to stop. So they leave. I spend 1 hour with the animal, and this is what I did. I'm sitting there. I pretend I'm Wags. I say that term. What does it feel like to be you, Wags? And so then I close my eyes. I'm Wags. I pretend that in my mind, Wags and I get up, take the hold of the door. I open the door. Wags and I go outside, go into my hallway, open up my front door, go onto the cool tile, step down onto the cool tile. I can feel the tile on my feet, on my paws. Open the screen. Step down onto the cement porch. I can feel the cement, cold cement. Step down onto the sidewalk. I start walking off onto the grass. I can feel the grass. Now, what animals need about going to the bathroom outside, they need to feel the grass, the openness, the wind, how open it feels. Then I could see him walking over to the bushes, lift his leg. Now this is what was really cute about him. I see him lifting his leg. Now, you can't just visually see him lifting his leg and the urine coming out. So what I added to it is I have a bad habit of holding it for like 4 or 5 hours. Then I run into the bathroom, sit down, and I go, oh, that feels so good. That sensation, I add that sensation to the visual, and then it's a take. I know, I get graphic.
You just can't be a visual.
I know I did, I just did. Good, you're good.
God. So,
that was real graphic. So, I add that visual to it, and that sensory to it, the animal gets it. So he says, I don't lift my leg. I shift my back hip so I don't get my front legs wet. Because he's only like almost a year old. So I tell him, Wags, that's okay. When you get to be a big dog, you may want to lift your leg. Then I give him a sniff, sniff, sniff. We're sniffing, sniffing, sniffing. And I feel I'm the dog doing this. Sniffing, sniffing. And then go in a circle. Now this is graphic. I'll be careful with this. Hump your back, and then feel the species coming out. I give them all of the detail that is necessary. Then I gave him a vision of kicking your back feet, feeling really great. Then walk onto the cement, up onto the step. I open the front door, walk in and feel the cool tile on your feet. Open my other door into the hallway, step onto the carpet, turn to the left, open my office door, and we're back into my small office. Then I give him inside what is expected inside. Roll on the carpet, play on the carpet, sleep on the carpet. And you notice how you can feel how still it is in here? Four walls, a ceiling, the floor. There's no wind in here. So I give him the feeling of what the sensation is in the environment and what to do. I was sitting there, and after I gave him the whole vision, this is what he did. He turned and looked at me because he got it. That all he had to do was change that one thing, and he started to cry. And I never heard a dog howl like a part animal where they howl, and an actually like a human cry, a scream. And I felt his pain. He has had his first family. And his first family had two little kids. And he adored that little five-year-old boy and the little small three-year-old child. He was with them all the time. And he lost that family because he went to the battle beside himself. He would not have lost that first family if he had known this is what he could have done. And when he cried, it hurt me so much to think he could have kept that family. He wouldn't have gotten dropped off with the Humane Society. He wouldn't have gotten another home. All because he didn't know. All because people were saying, God, I hope this dog doesn't crap on the floor again. I hope that he doesn't pee when I leave. I don't know what to do about him because he's always going on the bathroom, going to the bathroom on the carpet. All the messages that they're giving this animal is exactly what they don't want him to do. So I took him back a little bit farther to see what he was like before he was dropped off at the Humane Society and got his first family. And I found out he was to be a show dog. And when they breed these dogs, you know, they want them to look really nice. They want a certain size muzzle, certain length of a tail, certain size ears. And his nose was a little bit too short. So they dropped him off at the Humane Society, and he got his first family. Now, when he was a pup, for that first 6 months, he lived in a kennel inside a building, and it was acceptable to go to the bathroom beside himself. That's where he learned it. That's when I felt the pain of this dog, that's when I said, I don't care about my pain. I don't care how much nervousness I get, I'm going to stand up and talk about all the legs in the world. I'm going to help people understand how to talk to the animals so that they don't get dropped off. I don't care how much fear I have. And it was hard for me. Because I would get the runs, literally, for about 2 to 3 days before I would be able to stand up in front of people. My stomach would be in knots, but I'd still do it. Now it's 30 years later, and I don't have that problem anymore. Thank heavens, huh? So do you have it pretty clear on how to give the clear information? Do you know that all you really need to do is fantasize and daydream the action? And if you desire to do this, really and truly, the most powerful tools you have is your desire and your intention. With those two, you can do anything. You can fantasize anything. My mom and dad, my stepmother and dad, told me, because I had learning problems and I couldn't read, they said to me, you will only be able to do one thing in your life. You'll be a good mother because you're a nice person, that you're kind. So you'll be a good mother. They did not believe that I could achieve anything, anything. And I believed that for a while. I believed that for a while. And so for you, if you can fantasize, let's say one of you has a desire to be a vet and you think you have a little bit of problem. You hold that desire. You hold that belief in yourself. that you're capable, that you'll get high marks, that you'll make it through the test that you have to take, or whatever it is. You hold a vision of you completing it as if you've already done it. Because our minds are so capable. And you're going to learn new things because we're going into a time that is, the things that you guys are exposed to with the computers, we never even could dream about. You'll bring in new medicines. You'll bring in new ways of dealing with animals. And that starts with having an imagination and believing that you can do it. My most favorite quotation from Albert Einstein, I have two quotations I love. From hey, I like that. That's great. My most favorite quotation, I carry it with me. The first one is, imagination is more important than knowledge. The second is, here, you know why I like him? Because once he was talking, and I listened to a tape of him talking, and he was talking about how he received his theory on relativity, and I thought to myself, oh my goodness, that's how I get information. It comes in spherically with all the components present. That means with animals, I get the vision of maybe the sound, I get the sensation, I get visual flashes, I get feelings, like I do when I was walking with those horses or walking into the horse's field. All the components present. I put it down, write it down, I don't add any more to it, I don't take anything away. That's how I can receive information. Imagination is more important than knowledge. And the reason? He said you can study and you can gain knowledge. But if you wanted to find a new source of electricity, energy, which one of you will do, in order to do that, you have to have an imagination. You have to imagine that there is a new source out there. And when you imagine that there's a new source and you want to find this source, then you'll be guided to find that. My second one that I love from him is, I want to know God's thoughts, the rest are details. That's important to me because I want to be inspired because of the more. I feel it's important that we utilize our wonder of life to take us to some place that's more enchanting. This is too heavy. It's too boring. You know one of the things I like about Harry Potter is because it brings a little bit of magic in. Wouldn't it be wonderful that someday, like in Star Trek, we could actually beam me up, Scotty? Wouldn't that be awesome?
Lasers, man, oh yeah.
Yes. That somewhere in our future, we'll live that. Somewhere in our future of this planet, people will live that. I hope that I can experience it someday because I would love it. It would save me so much time traveling. Oh my goodness.
Or you can get a little car, toy
yes,
car,
and fly.
Put it on the ground, and take a gun and shoot it, and it comes with you.
And
oh, 99 cents sale.
Huh? Yeah.
On sale for 99 cents.
So, now let's talk about some problems that you have, and that we could really give you some clear visions and ways in which to pick up why the animal's doing it. Does somebody have a problem with one of their animals in here? Don't have any? What?
My dog and my turtle.
Your dog and your turtle?
Yeah, two different things.
Okay.
Okay, my dog licks a lot.
Okay.
A lot, like people's feet. Lick their hands.
Uh-huh, he's just a licker, 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 licker.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, let's say you want to find out why. Okay, this is what I'm going to give you homework. All right? And if you brought him to me, this is the first thing I do. If you take the solution away, you get to find out why an animal does something. His solution, the dog's solution, what's your dog's name?
Kyle.
Kai. Kai's solution about something that makes him feel acceptable about licking when somebody comes in, licking their hand or licking their feet. So if I want to know why, I would be the dog not being able to do the behavior. So pretty soon, if in your mind you're him and you can't lick, it's kind of like a person that wants to bite their nails and they can't bite the nails, their nervous system starts to get churned up. And then once I feel what the nervous system's doing, I feel an emotion. And once I feel the emotion and I identify the emotion, like, oh, this is fear. Or this is a feeling as if, will you care about me? Am I okay? Lick. I'm here. I'll be good. This kind of feeling, I'd write that down. Then I wouldn't add anything more to it. I wouldn't take anything else away. Then all of a sudden, once I identify with the emotion, I magnify that emotion. Then bingo, what would happen is I would be, a vision would come in as if the dog and I are a puppy, and I get to see exactly why he's doing it, why the dog made the decision to lick. And once I see what the decision is, let's say the decision is that he's taken away from the mother a little bit too soon, and he needs that nurturing, and being close to a person makes you feel like you have a blanket, or you have your mom right close to you, that comfort is there, that you're not going to be isolated. And so you're just licking, fulfills that need that it should have had more nursing. So how could we now help that dog to become grown up and feel safe that as if it didn't need to nurse anymore? So I would tell this dog, you're so grown up. You're a big dog now. And we love it when you just lay beside us and we pet you. I love it when you just lay beside us. That's what I would do with this dog. He's still a puppy.
Well, I don't know. He's big, but we've only had him for like 8 years. We got him when he was a puppy.
You got him when he was a puppy. How old was he?
I don't know.
You don't know? Sure. Was he like real young?
Like he had his eyes open and he was walking around in hyper.
He was hyper. Any other questions? Yes?
Oh, my cat likes, whenever you're doing anything, she likes to come and sit right in it and just lay out. Whenever you're like, kind of mom's putting a puzzle. Yeah, puzzle together, and she just came and she just laid right in the middle of the puzzle.
Oh. And this is what you would do, because, you know, she wants to be in the middle of the project. So I give her a vision. I love it when you lay right here. So have her walk in, lay down, and watch you put the pieces together. I tell her, I love it when you lay right here and watch me put the pieces together versus laying in the middle. Usually what happens is once they've done that, because they're saying, play with me, I like your focus. Pet me. I want a little bit of that energy, especially when you're doing something creative, you know, because they really like that. Because we get calm and we start enjoying it, and then they come in and go, oh, I like that. So give her vision of laying beside and that she can get stroked and watch each piece going to its place. Okay?
Two minutes.
This question here, and then we'll come back to
you. One of our dogs keeps digging holes all around the yard. Well, actually just in this one spot, right up against the cement.
Right up against the cement?
Yeah, just this long line of holes.
Oh.
You know, we've tried the no-dig spray and, you know, rubbing alcohol and stuff like that, and really spraying the holes and stuff, but she just keeps digging.
Part of it is, you know, wolves dig for dens, and some animals still hold a lot of nature in them. So this is what I would do, is I would tell her, we need you to dig in this one area that would be acceptable, and then see her watching and looking at all the rest of the area and get smooth by the walkway, that it's smooth, that the ground hasn't been dug up. And then give her a vision of looking at that area, walking over to this one spot and digging. so that you fulfilled her need
to
have a...
Well, it's like a grass. It's like causing all these huge holes inside of it. And on grass.
Can you,
you know, I mean, if it was like in the dirt part, but...
She doesn't dig in the dirt?
Mm-hmm. She just digs right in the grass.
In the grass.
In the grass.
Oh, my gosh. Then I would tell her, we need you to dig. Start the hole for her in the dirt. And also, pick it in a location where she feels like she's connected to the house. Because it feels to me that the area that she's doing it, it feels still like it's part of the house. Where if I went, and for some reason, I want to walk off this way to get to the dirt. And that doesn't turn me on at all. I want to stay more connected. So is the dirt over here?
Oh, yeah, here's the house, here's the backyard, you know, the grass, it's about here. And there's this strip of dirt where you have trees and plants. Mm-hmm. And there's just this blank piece of dirt.
Okay, I would give her visions, and I would start it and tell her, man, I love it. But the thing, in the vibes, you know how a vibration of a home, when you know how sometimes you walk in someone's home and it feels really good, you just want to hang out there, and then other people's homes will walk in and it's like, oh my gosh, they've had fights, it's uncomfortable in here, I want to leave. What I would do is think of the center of your house, the vibes, the good family vibes. I would feel that your family vibes include, that the living room includes the tree and the area that the dog's acceptable to dig in. I did that with my cats. I made the backyard feel like it's an extension of my house so that they would want to hang out in the backyard and not go any further. So that's what I would do.
All right.
You take only one more and then I got to close it up, guys. Yes.
Now, do you do a movie? Like in your head to tell them, or
yes,
pictures?
I do both. I make a move subjective, I am the animal doing the behavior. Objectively, I see the movie in my head of the person and the animal doing the behavior together. So it's two things. Objectively, you're doing the movie in your head of the animal making the changes. Subjectively, you are the animal doing the behavior. See the difference? The subjective is where, in some ways, it's a lot letting yourself be that animal by saying, what does it feel like to be you doing this? And trusting. Today when I was talking to the young elementary school kids, and in order for them to grasp it, this is what I was told to tell them. You know how, with those kids, I said, how many of you pretend that you're Superman or Spider-Man? Okay? When you pretend that you're somebody, you can almost feel it. That's what I do. You pretend that you're that being. So, you guys are really, really great. You're so intended. And I really appreciate the desire to want to know. Because when you put it into practice, it will become the norm for you. Because the reality is, this is a new century. You're at the beginning of a very new century. And in the beginning of a new century, usually something new science comes forward. Some form of new history comes forward. So in this new science that you're doing, it means that there will not be a time on the planet when interspecies isn't here. You're at the beginning of it.
Joining us at the Armadillo School. This is a charter school in Phoenix. It's November the 13th. It's the afternoon. And we have just concluded a very intensive focus training for Samantha. This is 2002. Thank you. This has been sponsored by the Southern Oregon Humane Society. And it is completely funded for Samantha's visit to this and the other schools in the area.
Is sponsored by by the Southern Oregon Humane Society, who have some very good projects for animals happening right here in Jackson County. And Samantha Curry has been working with communicating with animals for over 35 years. And I think that you're going to find that this is a fascinating and very exciting day. So, Mrs. Samantha Curry, please come over here and talk to us.
Have dogs.
Wow.